So lecture one review. This first lecture is basically a summary of everything that you're going to learn throughout the semester. And so you'll find that the topics that you're going to go through for the quiz are based upon some of the key concepts and lectures that you will eventually have. And since you haven't already had them yet, they're just going to be very on the surface. They're not going to be super in-depth. What you see is what you get from this initial lecture. So these questions will not be in the same order on the quiz, but everybody will get a certain set of questions that I'm going to go through for this review. And the same thing will be true for other reviews as well. So for example, everyone will get a question on cell theory. Now, as we've already gone over cell theory, there are many ways in which you can describe cell theory. So expect that some of you will get a question which may say which of the following is not correct or true about cell theory, and it will define cell theory as you see here, and there will be something else thrown in there that sounds maybe like it describes cell theory, but is not. Others will get a question that says which of the following is true regarding cell theory, in which case one of these definitions of cell theory will be up there and the others will be changed in some way so that they're not true. So that's kind of how this question is phrased. Again, you're going to have a variety of different ways I'm going to ask the same thing. So everyone's going to get a question on cell theory, but you have to be able to approach it at different ways because you just don't know which question you're going to get. And again, when you take the quiz for a second time, you may get a different version of this same concept. So everyone will get a question on cell theory. How that is portrayed is generally, like I said, which of the following is not correct or which of the following is true. Especially when you have questions that there are many definitions for, that's generally how those questions go on most quizzes anyway. Now, 9 out of the 10 questions will essentially be on what we talked about, the 5 characteristics of living organisms. And generally, you have about 2 per concept, but that would make 10. So what I'm saying is sometimes you'll get 1 of 1, and sometimes you'll get 2 of everything else. And so there's not really any clear definition as far as which one of those you only get 1 of, which one you only get 2 of, but they're set up in a way that everyone's at least going to get 1 question on each of these 5 concepts, and then a second question on most of these concepts. Now, sometimes the questions are phrased a little differently than what you see here. For example, you see the 5 characteristics of living organisms. That's how a lot of the questions will show up on the exam, where it'll say A, organize, B, use energy, C, maintain homeostasis, D, reproduce, and E, evolve. But there are a few here and there that are a little different than that, and I want to go over those as well as the general ones. For example, most of the life is organized questions aren't going to be this way in which they're phrased A, organized, or B, organized, whatever. They're going to be looking like this, where we talked about very specific levels of organization. Now, there's 2 questions that everyone's going to get on the quiz regarding biological organization. One of the questions will basically be a definition question. It'll be, you know, which of the following is made up of many different types of cells and come together to form a higher function, and the answer will be tissues, or which of the following is when atoms come together to form more complex structures, this forms, you know, molecules. They'll be definition questions. Now, that's why on your lecture notes that I've given you a lot of details about these, because that's one of your questions, is to just know these different levels of organization. Now, the second question that you're going to have is an application question, meaning I'm going to give you an example and you need to tell me what level of organization that is, okay? And these examples come straight out of your book, and they also come from the lecture. So you need to make sure that you've listened to the lecture and that you've read some of the examples in the books. Now, most of these examples, you know, show up like in this picture right here. They're going to show up as chloroplasts, right? As an organelle of plant cells. or they'll say a leaf is an example of an organ. So many of them are staring you right in the face. As long as you have this in front of you, not all of them, but a lot of them come from straight from the book and from the lecture. So make sure you can define these and make sure that you know examples of these that have been talked about in the lecture. That's pretty much how those questions on the quiz are going to be. The other questions are going to look more like this. They'll still have how life is organized, you know, and whatnot, but generally it's going to be these last four: energy use, homeostasis, reproduction, evolution. Now, again, these will be things where I talk about metabolism, photosynthesis, cellular respiration, things that we just discussed, and you're going to have to say, oh, that's how living things use energy. So you would choose energy use for your answer. But there's a different question, a second question, that has to do with the categories of life as it has to do with energy. And this has more to do with ecology and basically how ecosystems work. But these are terms that are used throughout the semester that you need to be familiar with. Producer, autotroph, those are synonyms, okay? Consumer, heterotrophs, those are also synonyms. So I can use one or the other. And then decomposer doesn't have a synonym here. So I will define these categories, and these will be the answers. It'll be producer, consumer, decomposer, and then I'll throw in some other stuff. In fact, one of the keys to help you with the quiz is if you see producer and autotroph in the same question as answers, you know it's wrong because they're synonyms. It's not just one in one situation and one in another. You would say, oh, both of those are the right answer. And I don't do questions like that where there's two right answers. So that's one of the ways that you could be like, oh, it's definitely not this, because that would mean there's two right answers. So just a little trick to be able to help with that. But generally, I'll give three of these and I'll throw in a couple other answers that seem legit or seem familiar from the quiz. So make sure you know these categories, because that's another question on the quiz. Homeostasis is one that doesn't come up as often. So generally, there's only one question on this on the quiz, but there could be two, like I said. And this will get into what we've talked about in terms of temperature regulation or blood sugar regulation or blood pressure regulation, you know, something to do with the human body that you are familiar with. I'm not going to really give you new things yet. We'll get into those. We'll get into how homeostasis works later on in more specific scenarios. But for now, I'm going to use things that are familiar to you. And so that one is not too difficult, because the answer will be homeostasis. And I'll give you an example of that. And you'll say, oh, that's homeostasis. Okay. Reproduction, growth, development. These generally have to do with mitosis and meiosis, asexual and sexual reproduction. Now, one question is very straightforward in terms of, you know, asexual and sexual reproduction are two ways in which life, you know, reproduces. But another question is a little more difficult, a little more critical thinking, and it gets into the concept of why sexual reproduction is more advantageous than asexual reproduction. Well, again, as we discussed, sexual reproduction basically diversifies the genetics of the species so that there is a broad spectrum. And that gives you more chances to be able to adapt to changes in the environment. You know, like we talked about with the bacteria, where they're all clones of each other, a single antibiotic will kill them all off. But if bacteria reproduced sexually, which they don't, and had a huge amount of diversity, it would be much more difficult to kill them because of that. Now, that's why humans have a lot of resilience, because of the diversity in which we have, as well as many other animal, plant, fungi species that reproduce sexually. So diversity, variation, that is what gives sexual reproduction or the species that reproduce sexually an advantage over those that don't. And then your final one on evolution. Obviously, we'll get into some of the basics that we've talked about. We'll get definitely into more depth later on at the end of the semester. But as most people generally know, evolution comes down to adaptation. And these adaptations ultimately allow the species to survive. But there's more to evolution than just survival. There's more to it than just natural selection. There are many other principles of evolution that drive change that exist in species that make them perfectly suited to their environment. So I generally give you examples like the adder snake or the hummingbird or something of that sort. And then you say, oh, that's evolution. So these aren't too difficult or complex either. It's just to introduce the basic concept. So that should spell out the first lecture for you in terms of what you need to focus on for those quiz questions.